Mental health, depression and suicide are big issues in New Zealand. In July 2017 to June 2018, 668 people took their own lives. And yesterday was Pink Shirt Day. The theme was to stop bullying, spread aroha and kindness. And joining us to talk about these important issues is prominent health educator Mike King and Dr Jemaima Tiatia-Seath. Thank you both for joining us on the
program.
Tanofa.
Mike, you're saying the current attitude of, you know, harden up, stay staunch, let's not talk about it, it's not helping people when they're dealing with these issues.
Well, I think the first thing we need to do is blow that myth out of the water. You know, we all say that Kiwi males in particular have this harden up, stay staunch attitude, but if you look at the stats and you look at the data, you'll find that 80% of people, 80% of men who are in crisis never ask for help. And the reason they never ask for help is because they're worried about what other people will think, judgment and stigma. They're worried about what other people will say, gossip, and they're worried about their reputation. How will this affect me going forward? So fear is the main reason people don't open up and talk, which is the opposite to the harden up, stay staunch. So I think what we need to start doing is shifting the message away from people in crisis and demanding that they come forward and ask for help, and ask the rest of us who aren't in crisis, what are we doing to make it okay for our friends, our family, our kids to open up and talk? Mm.
And Jemaima, especially that issue of toxic masculinity within our community, how big a concern is that, do you think?
I think it is a concern, and I'm glad we got this platform to speak about it. There was a recent study that myself and Caleb Masters did, a PhD candidate with Pacific Studies, and we looked at Pacific athletes in that environment and how they cope with their well-being.
These are men?
Yep. These are men, okay. Pacific men, and how it's quite stressful and pressurising, and how they balance their well-being in amongst those pressures. And more often than not, you'll find that, as Mike was saying, that fear of, I guess, exposing vulnerabilities, but also families and wives and partners not being able to identify or pick up on the signals when their brothers or sons or husbands aren't feeling well.
And, you know, it has been a really tough week for many of our community, especially, you know, with poor passing. You know, a lot of people have been thinking about it. I have been thinking about it. What do you do, though, if someone is going through, struggling? How do you look out for them, and how do you even pick up the signs?
Well, for me, a couple of things there. One, I think we've got to stop suicide profiling.
What do you mean by that?
So currently, if you go to the Ministry of Health's website and you say what to look out for in someone who is suicidal, or someone who's down in the dump, someone who's crying, someone who's locked in their room, someone who's got off their favourite food, someone who's not listening to their favourite music, every suicide funeral I have been to, you hear the same things. He was the funniest guy in the world. He was there. He was the strength of the community. She was the most loving person ever. She'd get up in the middle of the night and do anything for anyone. That's not in any of the profiling. So again, you know, it's forcing us to look in the wrong areas. We're looking for people who just have got the flu. Mm. Ah, you must be suicidal because you got to, no, I've got the flu. So what we need to do again is an empowering process. Let's create an environment where it is okay for people to ask for help. And it's really interesting you mentioned the sports teams. I've been speaking with the Hurricanes, with the Highlanders and the Chiefs, and predominantly Polynesian and Māori men, and our Pākehā brothers too. But there is a desire to be more vulnerable.
Okay.
But no one is giving our young men permission to be vulnerable. And the onus for that is on my generation. My generation have to give them permission. How do we do that? Not by telling them to be more vulnerable, by showing them that we can be vulnerable as
Jemaima,
well.
Jemaima, you want to add to that?
Yes, and it is an approach of compassion and care and being non-judgmental.
Do you think like we're too tough, like especially in our Pacific families towards, you know, our young
people? I guess it's just not being equipped to tackle those situations, and people do, they clam up when they're confronted by something like that. But it's a general discussion, and we can't expect people to go and seek services themselves because they're not in the right frame, you know, not feeling too well. It's up to families and colleagues and sportsmates to be able to step in and guide them through those tough times.
Okay. You said about you do clam up, and I'm unsure, you know, what to say exactly. You mentioned to me yesterday it's about having really honest discussions with someone. Tell me more about that again.
It's not so much like when you do speak with someone who you're concerned about. It is asking them, look, I know you've just gone through a marriage breakup. I know you're going through a financial crisis. You must be feeling pretty crappy right now. How do you feel? You know, it's
and coming with no judgment.
With no judgment or trying to fix it.
Because we do that,
Of course.
And walking them through the process. Don't say, give them a referral number and then expect them to make the call or walk to the service. Guide them through the whole process.
Okay. And Mike, you've been through this yourself, yep. You know, these struggles. Look, how about you? What do you...
Pick on? I'm maybe speaking out of turn here, but it's really hard for young Pacific Islanders to make their way in the world. I mean, your people are genuinely walking through two worlds. Mm. You've got this hierarchical system where you know the head of the family is the chief, and then you have the church on top of that, where and then you're sending your kids out to university to battle in a white world where it's dog eat dog.
Jemaima, how big is that? You know, our kids trying to hold those two identities.
Negotiating,
you know,
all those identities is an issue. But if we look at the larger systemic issues, we find that stuff like institutional racism, yep. Cultural incompetence, you know, it's not completely a community or family's issue. It's a whole government, yep. Whole right. Community approach.
Well, it really is a community issue. We've all got to sit down. So as human beings, we're really quick to ask who's doing what, because it's a lot harder looking in the mirror and going, what am I doing? But I think if we all have that honest conversation with ourselves and look in the mirror, and instead of saying, what's everyone else doing, what am I doing? And then we all get into a room with that positive attitude, not looking to blame governments, not looking to blame communities, not looking to blame religion, not looking to blame anyone, just what can we all do? Let's put one thing on the table, one positive thing that I can do, share it with everyone, have everyone put these positive ideas on the table and then act on them.
Thank you both for coming on the show. I know we're we'll talk more online, and if you want to share anything as well online, please do. Look, if you or someone know needs help, you can call Lifeline on 0800 543 354. That's 0800 Lifeline, or the Suicide Crisis Helpline, 0508 Dautoko, and you can head to our Facebook page. We'll put all the further links there. And just reach out. Anyone will be there to listen as well.